see, for anybody who is objective at all, is we're seeing a totalitarian system now unveil itself. And ever since essentially 9/11 happened, it's been more and more of these draconian measures that are leading us right down the road to martial law.
Particularly to hear President Obama claim the power to keep people in prison indefinitely with no charges against them, no conviction, no sentence, just imprisonment. It's particularly stunning to hear him make that claim in the middle of a speech that was all about the rule of law.
This last week, the U.S. Congress passed a bill which repeals Hasek Comitatus, which means that we have now institutionalized and codified martial law. Right now, the battle against terrorism involves all of us. Everybody in this country is a potential terrorist.
We don't even understand freedom anymore. We are a country that is headed towards socialism, totalitarianism, beyond your wildest imagination. I have to tell you, I'm doing a story tonight that I wanted to debunk these FEMA camps. I'm tired of hearing. You know about them?
Sure.
I'm tired of hearing. I wanted to debunk them. Well, we've now for several days done research on them. I can't debunk them.
I don't know anything about them.
It is our government. If you trust our government, it's fine. If you have any kind of fear that we might be headed towards a totalitarian state, look out, buckle up. There's something going on in our country that is ain't good.
And they find a little red dot or a little blue dot on their mailbox, and they wonder what the little red dot and blue dot is. Well, it's marking your mailbox by the government, so when foreign troops come in here on us after martial law, but if you have a blue dot, they take you to the FEMA camps being built by Halliburton right now to house 50 million Americans. They're building enough concentration camps in America by Halliburton. So I'm going to tell all of you, if you have not bought ammunition, if you have not bought guns, go get them now. Go get them now, because you won't be able to get them much longer.
Change has come to America.
Practice Christianity and you could be court-martialed. That could be the new law of the land for our armed forces, thanks to a proposal by a religious tolerance group that claims Christian evangelists are predators.
Is a war on religious liberty within the military, and that the Christianity of service members is now coming under attack by the Obama administration.
It's so incredible. Here's a new article by Kurt Nemo that's got links to Fox News, Denver papers, you name it. The state police have gone public and said we're in federal training now where they're asking us, will we confiscate guns from Christians? Now, do you understand how even more illegal that is? Behind the scenes, they're training for what can only be called a foreign authoritarian takeover of this country via the federal government and the foreign banks. Here's the article. Colorado troopers trained to consider Christians as dangerous terrorists. Absolutely amazing. And it's all bibliographed. It's all linked to it being announced, to it being reported.
The company has now implanted two workers with microchips to monitor their movements, causing some to charge invasion of privacy. The company says it's merely a layer of security beyond key cards and clearance codes. If I don't get one of those soon. Well, joining me now is Lance Uhlenhoff, editor-in-chief of PC Magazine. Lance, this sounds like some freaky science fiction book. Tell us what this is about. These two workers have microchips?
Right. Well, this is very, very real, and these microchips are about the size of a grain of rice. They get injected into your skin.
Futuristic film, humans injected with a tiny chip holding the key to all of their private information.
But as you're about to see in our CBS 46 investigation, it's not fiction. In fact, it's being marketed in Georgia as life-saving technology. Life-saving technology.
We have a Florida family who are really pioneers in a brave new world. They have volunteered to be the first ever to have microchip identification devices implanted into their bodies.
It is the first implantable microchip for humans. It has multiple security, financial, and healthcare applications.
One thing I would just suggest, I'm just an outside, soon-to-be investor. I love this idea, by the way, Scott. I think this...
The Northside Independent School District in San Antonio has put tracking chips in the ID badges for more than 4,000 high school students.
Well, it looks and sounds like something out of the future, but a new palm scanning device will help Bossier Parish schools keep better track of what children are eating now. The electronic device will be implemented at all Bossier Parish schools.
Now we're seeing a complete totalitarian takeover of the United States of America. And we've been talking about this for years now. This is the police state. This is the police state. This is what a total breakdown of our society looks like. But we're seeing all of this intensify. This is all intensifying around the Second Amendment. Should we be able to own guns or not? Let's take guns away from the people. These are very big, very hardcore issues.
No matter what your purpose is, you must leave. If you do not disperse, you may be arrested and or subject to other police action. The use of riot control agents and or less lethal munitions, which could cause risk of injury to those who...
Every person on United States soil or international soil can be deemed as a terrorist. They have really any reason to want to detain you. They don't need to acknowledge your Fourth Amendment rights.
It's what supported things like the Patriot Act and now the NDAA and the ever-encroaching police state.
By order of the City of Pittsburgh Chief Police, I hereby declare this to be an unlawful assembly. I order all those assembled to immediately disperse.
My guest has spent 30 years studying the mark of the beast. And he says our computers and our television sets have the capability for anyone from the government on down at will, whether they're turned on or not, to watch what we're doing right in our office, right in our home. This technology is getting out of control. Now, you're probably familiar with my guest, Paul McGuire. You might have seen him on Fox News, O'Reilly, History Channel. I mean, one of the top viewing shows. But as a young man, you had quite a background. You were raised to hate Christians. You thought the answer was in science and the New Age. So you go out to the University of Missouri, where you're really debating Christians and you're going to put them in their place. Guess what his major was? You'll never guess, so I shouldn't have said guess. His major was altered states of consciousness. That's a major? And he's in class one day and he hears a voice. What does the voice say to you?
It was an audible voice which said, surrender to the dark forces within.
And what'd you do about that?
I freaked out. I never heard an audible voice before, and I looked around to see if anybody had heard it.
Okay, so he's tearing these Christians apart, but their love is kind of contagious. So he goes to a retreat meeting, and he says, oh, no, they're all hypocrites. I'm leaving this place. But he doesn't have a car, so he hitchhikes. Tell me about your adventure.
Well, right after the religious retreat, which confirmed my worst suspicions about Christianity being a country club religion, the place looks like a Field of Dreams, the movie, the cornfields in right. The middle of nowhere. I stick out my thumb on the road. A Pentecostal preacher and his wife picks me up in their car. And being from New York City, I said, okay, great, we're in the cornfields, and there's probably a lot of Pentecostal right. preachers and their wife. They share with me the gospel of Jesus Christ.
He is the only way to heaven. He will save you.
Then they let me out on the road again. I stick out my thumb again. Within seconds, a station wagon pulls up. It's a guy in a dark three-piece suit like an undertaker. He's a Bible salesman.
Does he have many Bibles in his car?
Yes, he has, I don't know, 100 King James Bibles. You know, the big, thick ones.
Oh, I know.
So he's driving down the back roads of Missouri. He lets go of the steering wheel. It looked like a 65-pound King James Bible. He's looking at me, not the freeway, and he's preaching, and he gets right down to it. He says, did you know that you're a sinner, and that if you don't accept Jesus Christ into your life, you're going to go to hell, and you need to be born again? I mean, that basically was it. I'm from New York. I didn't even believe in the word sin. That was an archaic concept. And he says, you want to pull up the road and say the sinner's prayer? And I said, yeah. But inside my mind, I'm going, great. He's a religious axe murderer pervert. He's gonna chop my head off before he does whatever and bury me in the bushes and say a couple of prayers over me. So I prayed with him. It was a real short prayer. Jesus Christ, I ask you to forgive me for my sins. I ask you to come into my life and make me born again. So I forgot about it.
So then a few days later, he's in New York. He's at a place called the Lamb's Club. Briefly, what occurred?
Well, what happened was I was discussing my experience with people who had been witnessing to me. And as I was sharing this hitchhiking experience, a girl who we had never met before came over to me and said, I couldn't help but overhearing your conversation. She said, I'm a minister's daughter. I was wrestling with these same questions as Jesus Lord. And for some reason, she looks right at me and she says, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? And I'd never said this before, but the words blurted out of me, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. At that moment, the sky cracked open and I saw God, not in a physical sense, but a spiritual sense. And I knew instantaneously that all the cosmic consciousness, astral projection, altered states of consciousness, all that stuff was illusions and false. And I knew that Jesus Christ was the Son of God instantaneously.
That is God. Now, what happens next is so amazing because he then devotes his life to studying prophecy and studying what's going on in the world. And then God starts giving him supernatural dreams to direct his research. Tell me a few things you found out about the one world currency.
Well, first of all, I do a tremendous amount of research from mainstream sources. It has to be documented. It has to be credible. Number two is I study Bible prophecy and the Old Testament and New Testament. But the third component is I do research where the Holy Spirit leads me and guides me into specific areas of research. So as I'm researching this, I notice that in the Old Testament, the Tower of Babel or Babylon is the world's first one world government, one world religion, one world economic system. That's clue one. Then I get into Revelation 13 and I read about the one world government, the one world economic system, one world religion, the false prophet, the religious false prophet, and the Antichrist. And then I see that in Revelation, it talks about a global government and a global economic system. And you can't buy or sell without getting the mark of the beast. And then I realize that everything that was predicted 2,000 years ago is coming to life in this world now, even as we speak.
Give me one fact that'll knock me out.
Well, one fact is that the international banking elite have planned for there to be a world currency by 2018. Now, that doesn't mean they'll hit the date, but the target date is 2018, and they intend to bring in a one world currency called the Phoenix, which just happens to be the bird on the back of the dollar bill. That bird on the back of the dollar bill is not a eagle, it's a phoenix.
And what is a phoenix symbolic of?
It's an occult, ancient occult symbol that goes back to Phoenicia.
So what is going to happen to our currency when there's a new currency? I want to find out. How about you?
Right back to It's Supernatural.
Okay, so we're headed towards this one world currency system. And my natural question is, what's going to happen to the U.S. dollar? I have a personal need to know.
The personal dollar is bye-bye. The proof of that would be the super billionaire George Soros that most people are aware of. I was watching him on the BBC speak to about 25 million Europeans live, and he quite openly spoke about the fact that the plan is to devalue the dollar. And the purpose for devaluing the dollar is you can't bring in a world currency if you have a strong dollar. So you have to lower the dollar to equalize the playing field. That way you can merge the currencies into one, a one world currency. And he came out and basically said that on BBC. He was very open. So he said the goal is to devalue the dollar. And then he said we're going to bring in a one world currency. But then he also said that part of the goal is to transfer the wealth out of the American middle class and middle class from other nations, transfer the wealth out of the middle class into third world nations, which some people may think is Christians, but it's going to go into the hands of dictators. So it's going to reduce the dollar, but also it's going to destroy the middle class. You'll have an elite upper class, and you'll have a giant lower class or worker class.
Now, lots of things are going on simultaneously. I don't think I've ever seen a time in history where so much Bible prophecy is happening.
Well, you're absolutely right. There has never been more prophetic signs coming true in one generation to this extent ever before in the history of mankind. So we're not just talking about economically and politically and spiritually, we're talking about scientifically and in every realm of society. We are moving at lightning speed to the tribulation period, and we're moving at lightning speed to the return of the Messiah. The number one prophetic time clock is Israel, God's prophetic super sign,
right,
which began as a nation in 1948.
Okay, you have, through your dreams and visions and Bible prophecy and research, predicted things that would happen. Tell me a few.
A number of years ago, I was doing research, and the Lord began to supernaturally tell me to write about and investigate people. And this was before 9/11. This is before the trade centers went down. The Lord told me to investigate Saddam Hussein, Osama bin Laden, the twin trade towers, weapons of mass destruction, EMPs, Iraq, Iran, and all of those geopolitical leaders and events that became popular language after 9/11. But I was researching and talking about it before 9/11 prophetically because I was open to the supernatural leading of the Holy Spirit. And I just want to say this one thing. That supernatural leading of the Holy Spirit, before today's program is over, there is going to be a very strong move of the supernatural force. And if people will be open to it, and they don't have to be religious to be open to it, by the time today's program is over, they are going to experience firsthand perhaps one of the most powerful experiences supernaturally that they've ever had in their lives.
Let me explain something. God did not leave us defenseless. God is going to do this for you because he knows what the future holds. And he wants you to not be under. He wants you to be the head. Now, you have been studying the mark of the beast and technology. Tell me some of the things you're finding.
Well, one of the most important things that I've found, and this again was the Holy Spirit supernaturally leading me into these fields of study, is that I began to understand that the modern science of mind control is a science, and it's about 200 years into the future, almost like science fiction than most people realize. But here's the thing about the science of mind control. Everybody knows that biotechnology has gone through the roof. Everybody knows that computer technology has gone through the roof. But the average American does not know that the science of mind control is just as much a technology, and it's about 200 to 300 years in the future. So, to put this in very clear terms, there are huge masses of people on planet Earth, especially in America, that would include politicians, the highest politicians, cultural leaders, the leaders in all kinds of fields, that are, in a sense, Manchurian candidates. They've been programmed and they're unaware of it. But the most frightening and disturbing thing of all that I found is that there is a mass mind control experiment going on now. And the easiest way to say it, it's a mass Manchurian candidate mind control operation where you can program scientifically an entire population.
Wow. Did you understand what he was saying? Electronically, an entire population. You know, when tell me if there's a good analogy. When Adolf Hitler would speak, the people were like mesmerized. So you're saying when, say, a politician speaks, this technology will cause them to be mesmerized to do whatever?
Yeah, and you're absolutely right, Sid. One of the areas that the Lord prophetically and supernaturally told me to research was Adolf Hitler about 20 years ago. I had no interest in researching Adolf Hitler. I spent 20 years researching him. And I began to realize that his ability to speak so powerfully and persuasively was supernatural, but it was more than that. It was advanced scientific mind control wedded with the occult. So when you look at Hitler's life, he was surrounded by occult teachers and the Vril Society, the Thule Society, who taught him the dynamics of body language, how to use his vocabulary to persuade the masses. And they trained him systematically, step by step, the very fact that he was called the Father and other things. He was using mind control on the German masses. All the symbols of the Third Reich are not accidental. Number one, they're occult symbols. But number two, they were scientific mind control in action. And the lesson we need to learn is, look how far and how dangerous mind control can be.
But listen, everything he is saying is telling me one thing. Jesus is coming back soon.
Right back to It's Super.
You know, with all these advances in technology, and Daniel spoke about it, that there would be an increase in knowledge in the last days. And I was thinking an increase in knowledge of God's word, which there is. But there's also an increase in the devil's information, his mind control and things like that. And many people are really concerned. What would you say to them? Because this is pretty dark stuff you've been talking about.
It's very dark stuff. And, you know, I cried out to the Lord for an answer. And the Lord spoke to me, and he said that in the last days, as these problems accelerate, that God was going to pour out his supernatural power in an unprecedented force and manner. And as I'm joining you now, I just want to share with you very briefly that no matter what situation you're facing, whether you're religious or not, that right now as you're watching this TV program, the supernatural power of God is flowing through this studio into your bedroom or living room or wherever you are, and you can feel it. It's like a tangible force. It's like electricity is filling your room, and you can sense the overwhelming power of God. Now, I just want to encourage you. That's going to give you the power you need to live triumphantly in the days to come. But no matter what you're facing, the Lord simply wants you to just receive His force as He extends it to you now. So whatever you're facing, whatever challenge or problem you have, at this moment, the Lord delights in proving His reality, not with talk, but with power.
And you know what? I can feel this in the presence of the name of Jesus. The power of the Holy Spirit is going to tangibly come into you right now.
Absolutely right. So what I want to share with you is, as you feel this incredible power and supernatural force flood into your room, and you can feel it, I just want to ask you to make the choice to receive it. So you're feeling the supernatural force of God with an overwhelming sense that Jesus Christ is touching you now. And we're not talking about words or hypnosis. We're talking about the power of God moving through the airwaves, through this studio, and it's flooding your bedroom and your office. And all you have to do is respond to it, and God is going to do something absolutely incredible for you.
Pray right now.
Lord, I ask in the name of Jesus that whatever problem a person is facing, whether you're an influential leader or an ordinary person, whatever your need is, whatever you're struggling with is, I ask in the name of Jesus that the power of the Holy Spirit that is flooding this studio would move into your life right now. And in Jesus' name, I say to you that you are experiencing a supernatural miracle. Simply receive it, and you will see just how powerful God is.
Have you seen a third great awakening?
Yes. I was doing research on this subject and saying, God, is there any hope for America? Because a lot of people are blinded by a dark supernatural force where they think everything has to get worse and I'm just a victim. And I just want to say to those people, that idea that everything has to get worse and you're just a victim is a demonic attack. It's an attack from principalities and powers. And the Lord wants you to rise up. It's not God's will for America to be destroyed. But God said, if the repentance is real and my people will truly seek my face, He will send His power upon this nation with such great force, it will transform it.
Last word, hopelessness. It's a spirit. You get out in Jesus' name, because there is hope in the Messiah.
Currently and historically, opposed to secret societies, secret oaths, and a secret proceedings. We decided long ago the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment. Pertinent facts far outweighs the dangers which are cited to justify it.
Face the facts, join our hands, make a stand. It's time to gather plans, get the shot, take the chance. Till there is no one left, stay correct to the death. They can't ever break a freedom, we will never let it. The corrupt politics is killing the system. Cynicism is it and it's everything that you witness. They tell you what to think, make you believe that they're the realness. They feed us full of lies and yet we always forgive them. Huh? It's all conspiracy, and if you feed it in a witch, you're the puppet, the government's pulling strings from above you. It's time for the introduction to truth. Let's start a movement. We've all been brainwashed. They believe that we all are stupid. We believe in what we see and whatever our ears are hearing. But if you look close, listen, gather your own opinion, you'll understand all the lies, lines, and what's between them. This world is not your oyster. This world is a fucking prison. Come on. happening in our nation. No one will stand up for the fear of assassination. So they strip us of everything, we stand there and just take it. We're scared to make a stand, a false flag operation. Research Illuminati, find out by 9/11. You see they line their pockets, don't believe the lies they tell it. Find us, seek the truth, realize we need to do whatever it is we can to protect our livelihood. It's time for us to prove whether conspiracy or not. They owe some explanations to the questions that we got. What are the skull and bones? What is lying beneath? All these secretive meats got you lying between your teeth. What's with the Bilderberg? I'm burning your effigies. I'm praying a Lucifer. How Satanist can you be? While all of the time praying you believing in the beast, just to keep up appearances within Christianity. Come on. Try to shut us down or turn around, let us storm them. We got the warnings, let us march from the morning through the night. We gon' fight and close the eye and overthrow all these damn secret societies. Why we gotta stand for the new world proprieties? The evidence is clear, we're naive to the lies. Illuminati wolves killing sheep in the night. When will we learn? When will we see what is right underneath all our eyes? It's whole time realize we've been deceived and they're trying to deplete us. They brainwashed our minds. May our souls stay free from corruption. Never trust them, let them get ahead. Even if we chant a march to the very end. Nevertheless, let them know we will never rest. Fill our bitty and my beatry, I'm not the end. Come on.
Tienen prohibidos de sobrevolar los Polo Norte y Polo Sur. And it's astonishing that the planes, the pilots are prohibited to fly over the poles, North Pole, South Pole, Arctica, Antarctica.
One thing leads to another. And when I started reading this, it's one of these things in your life, when you read it, you'll never forget it, all right? I'll never forget this. I'll never forget it because of the implications involved in it. First of all, it's the testimony of an honorable man. Admiral, he's an admiral, he's gone on now, but Admiral Byrd, Richard Byrd. Here's the man who flew over the North Pole and was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor. And I read the statement attached to that, how that he risked his life and so forth. He flew over the South Pole. That's not all he did, though. After the war, he led expedition to South America with over 4,000 troops and 8, 9, 10, 12 warships. And it was called Operation High Jump. Never heard of it. But when you find out about one thing, it leads to another thing.
Open your mind.
But let's get into it quickly, because you're wondering what's going on. The man's an aviator. He's a pilot. And he leaves at 0600 hours. That's 6 o'clock in the morning for folks that, you know, if you're not familiar with the 24-hour clock. 0600 is 6 o'clock in the morning. He flies out, and he's headed north. He gives updates as to his flight, to turbulence that he gets in the air. He drops his altitude, raises his altitude, standard procedures of any pilot. And he does this, and he talks about how he does it, and continues to fly. He has constant radio checks with his base, so they'll know where he is. They can keep up with him. And back in those days, they didn't have GPS and all of that stuff, so they flew by what's called dead reckoning a lot of times. And pilots know exactly what I'm talking about when I'm talking about dead reckoning. He continues to talk to them until he comes. He's flying over the ice. He's flying over the North Pole. And what do you expect to see? Nothing but ice. That's what you expect to see. One sheet of ice after another sheet, just solid white ice, snow, the North Pole. Until he sees a creature down below, which looks to him like a mammoth, and he drops his altitude to about 1,400 feet, and it is a mammoth.
Open your mind.
And this begins to really get his attention. He sees a mountain range, and at 10 o'clock in the morning, so now he's been in the air for 4 hours, he says he crosses over the small mountain range and still proceeding northward as best can be ascertained. Beyond the mountain range is what appears to be a valley with a small river or stream running through the center portion. There should be no green valley below, no green valley in the Arctic. No green valley. And something is definitely wrong and abnormal here, he says. We should be over ice and snow. To the port side, port is left, starboard is right. To the port side are great forests growing on the mountain slopes.
Open your mind.
Our navigation instruments are still spinning, and the reason they're spinning is because he's approaching magnetic north. And the magnetic pole, if you ever get around the magnetic pole, you forget your magnetic compass. It's not going to work because the magnetism is so intense, and the movement is so great that it's no use to you. But in any event, he says his navigational instruments are spinning. The gyroscope is oscillating back and forth. Then he sees this beneath, and he says, at 1,400 feet, I execute a sharp left turn to better examine the valley below. It is green with either moss or some type of tight-knit grass. The light here seems different. I cannot see the sun anymore. We make another left turn, and we spot what seems to be a large animal of some kind below. It appears to be an elephant. No, it looks more like a mammoth. This is incredible, he says, yet there it is. He decreases his altitude to 1,000 feet and he takes binoculars to better examine the animal. It is confirmed it is definitely a mammoth-like animal. Report this to base camp.
Open your mind.
At 10:30 hours, he encountered more rolling green hills. The external temperature indicator reads 74 degrees Fahrenheit. He's in the North Pole. Continuing on our heading now, navigation instruments seem normal now. I'm puzzled over their actions. Attempt to contact base camp. Radio is not functioning. And now what follows is one of the most incredible things I've ever read in my life. And let me put it in the context of this. When Satan showed the Lord Jesus Christ the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, he did just that. He has power. And there are things going on that there is absolutely no physical definition or logical reasoning to. But the existence of it cannot be denied. And this is what's happening here. In 11:30 hours, countryside below is more level and normal. If I may use that word, ahead we spot what seems to be a city. This is impossible. Aircraft seems light and oddly buoyant. The controls refuse to respond. My God, he says, off our port and starboard wings, a strange type of aircraft. They're closing rapidly alongside. They're disc-shaped and have a radiant quality to them. They are close enough now to see the markings on them. It is a type of swastika. This is fantastic. Where are we? What has happened? I tug at the controls again. They will not respond. We're caught in an invisible vice grip of some type. 11:35 hours, our radio crackles and a voice comes through in English with what appears to be a slight Nordic or Germanic accent. The message is, welcome, Admiral, to our domain. We shall land you in exactly 7 minutes. Relax, Admiral. You are in good hands. I note the engines of our plane have stopped running. The aircraft is under some strange control and is now turning itself. The controls are useless. In plainer words, he's been taken over completely. Now, up to this point, you're going to say to yourself, well, this is a madman. Or you may say to yourself, I know the power of the devil. I know how he can deceive. And what follows, he is taken into a city by blonde-haired men who look like these Aryans that Hitler and the rest of them are talking about in Germany. And then he's finally taken to their leader. And when he's taken to their leader, he has a conversation with him. He's their master. And that master tells him that essentially that they've been observing us on top of the earth where we live for a long time. And that we have gotten to the point by killing each other, and they're talking about the atomic bomb that had just been recently dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. You know those two. This happened in 1947, I think this happened. These bombs had just recently been dropped. They were dropped April the 3rd, 9th, 1945, somewhere in April. These bombs had just been dropped in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and they were saying that we are going to have to do something with the people who dwell on Earth because you have gotten out of hand. All right. They tell Admiral Byrd that he's an honorable man, and they ask, and he asks him, why am I here? They said, because you're chosen to be here. You're a man that we can trust. We're going to tell you what's happening. We're going to tell you all of this. They tell him. They send him back. All right, he goes back apparently and reports this to the United States government, because remember, he is a military officer accountable to his chain of command. So he goes back and he tells his superiors. And apparently they tell him to hush this up. This stays hushed until right before he dies, this diary comes out. Because he says, I cannot leave this world.
Open your mind.
Without letting humanity know what has happened. I cannot leave. I must tell them what happened. Now, before we go any further, let's ask ourselves some questions. Number one, did he write this diary? Is this Admiral Byrd's diary? Did he really write this? Number two, if he really did write this, and this is legitimate, this is his diary, then something obviously happened to this man when he was over the North Pole. Something happened. Something obviously happened to this man. Number three, regardless of whatever happened to this man, he's convinced something happened to him. So it's incumbent upon us, what did happen to him when he was over the North Pole? All right. If you press this thing a little further and do a little more studying into it, you'll find out that there's an awful lot of people out there that believe the Earth is hollow. That it's not. There's not a molten mass in it like they say. Now, if you're a Bible believer, you know this. You know that the heart of this earth, hell, is located. If you believe the Bible, all right? If you believe the Bible. And if you believe the Bible, the book of Revelation makes it very plain that the bottomless pit, which is hell, was opened, and out of that pit came these creatures upon the earth. They're coming out on the earth. They're coming out on the face of the earth. Now, that's a wild thing.
Open your mind.
This is why a lot of churches in this country, an awful lot of churches in this country, absolutely refuse to read or study the book of Revelation or preach from it, because it has some things in it that just literally blow your mind. And that's one of them, talking about creatures coming up out of the bottomless pit, Apollyon and Abaddon and all of that. But if I'm a Bible believer, I believe it's real. You can get off and you can get way out in left field with a hollow earth theory, all right? And you can get in deep into all of this stuff that I'm just going to present it to you this morning in the context of what we're studying, because we're studying a deceit that's coming on this earth of unbelievable proportions. A deceit, all right? A deceit. Now, we know that Adolf Hitler, when he was Chancellor of Germany, was deep into the occult. We know they didn't do anything unless they consulted their occult masters and prognosticators and what have you. And that the German high command, Himmler and men like that, even Himmler himself was far more into the occult than Hitler, and Hitler was head over heels into it, but Himmler was deep into it.
Open your mind.
These men were guided every moment of their life by an occult satanic power and spirit. Germany did definitely develop during World War II some of the highest technology on the earth. I saw this the other day on the History Channel, and I didn't know this. Nobody had ever told me this. But this is what the History Channel reported, that two German scientists in the 30s, these two German scientists had split the atom. Now think hard on that.
Open your mind.
Think hard on that. And it was the German scientists, Werner von Braun, men like that, who got America into space. That's a fact, folks. That's a fact, no question about that. The only reason they didn't put them to death at Nuremberg with the trials was because they needed them. And so they needed their technology, what happened. Anyway, Germany apparently was way ahead of the rest of the world in some of this technology. Germany had a society called the Vril Society, V-R-I-L. How many's ever heard that term? Most people haven't, but a few of you have, all right? That's an occult society. But the premise of the Vril Society was this, They were able to tap into satanic power and apply it to physical things. See? They were able to tap into satanic, to occult power. They called it whatever force they called it. We know what it is. The power is either of God or the devil. But they tapped into it, and they were able to apply it to physical things. There are photographs of flying saucers the Germans made. I've seen them. But they're not flying saucers like you know, the classic example of them. But they are flying saucers. In other words, they are propelled by a propulsion system that was unknown by most of the world at that time. But in any event, the bottom line is that the Germans had tapped into the occult world and had begun to build this system based on what they were getting from the occult world. And that system was this. They believed that in the north,
open your mind,
that there was an entrance into a hollow earth, and that spirit beings lived there that were vastly superior to us, and that these spirit beings were our forefathers, and that's what Hitler was trying to do, was to try to bring the race back, the Aryan race, back to its roots, back to what it should be. And this is why the root race theory is so important when you get into this stuff. You remember I told you about the root race? You remember which one I told you the Aryan was?
Open your mind.
There's seven of them. Five, exactly. Five. It's number five. It's the fifth. And this root race theory, the Theosophists taught it. Blavatsky in Russia taught it. All of this evolutionary, spiritual evolutionary that brings this super race, this super identity, these people believe that. The evolution, when you talk about biological evolution, all right, you're talking about what they teach at UT and all the major colleges in the world, they teach biological evolution. What is biological evolution? That's what Charles Darwin taught, right? All right, that's simple enough on the surface of it for people to relate to. Biological evolution. I don't believe it, but that's what they teach. All right. Then there is social evolution. All right? Political correctness is a product of social evolution. What's social? Well, if biological evolution is true, then social evolution is where the masses and humanity and governments are able to learn how to live in peace and blah, blah, and so forth. In plain words, social evolution means that there must be a one world government for men to live. That's social evolution. See, that's not biological evolution. But the idea is that if evolution is true, they believe it is, then therefore that justifies the idea, well, men must live together. Then there is this esoteric, this spiritual, this,
open your mind,
this stuff here we're talking about that Admiral Byrd saw. There is that type of evolution. And this gets into the mystical category of it. Because this gets into that highbrow stuff about the spirit beings that are channelers and guides and are communicating with people. And the U.S. government would never tell you this, but they've had all kinds of experiments into this. And they've got labs, and they've got underground labs, and they're doing experimentation into this stuff. And and all of this is going on right now, and people go off on the deep end when they get into it. And you got to be awful careful with it, because you can get into this stuff and you can become possessed by these spirits, because these are demons.
Open your mind.
And these demons are smart. Admiral Byrd saw something. I don't doubt that for a minute. But he did not see a civilization of advanced beings that had evolved to that point. What he saw was either an apparition or a physical manifestation of some spirit power that's demonic. That's what he saw. But it blows my mind to begin to realize how powerful it is.
Open your mind.
What I'm going to say to you this morning, I want to say it to you, and I want you to take it to heart. When the deception comes, if you're not a born-again believer, you'll be swept away with it. The deception will be greater than you ever imagined in your life. It is going to be profound as to what happens. When Ted Gunderson talked about, now put it together, he talked about people in the high places are Satanist. What he's talking about, they're Illuminati. He's talking about spiritual power in high places that will bring about a one world government. And by doing that, they intend to rule the world. And they have the help of a whole a mass of demonic spirits who are able to perform all kinds of miracles, deceptive miracles, manifestations, and all of this stuff to help them to bring about that one world government. And the goal is so that they can put one man up and worship him as God, the Antichrist. Now, there is a mind behind all of it. There's a mind directing it, and that mind is the devil, Lucifer. He wants worship. He wants worship. He covets worship.
Open your mind.
He does. And money's nothing to him. And the souls of men and power's nothing to him. He's got power. He covets worship. That's why he said to the Lord Jesus Christ, you fall down and worship me, and I'll give you the kingdoms of the world. He covets it. Now, I read something yesterday. You might find it hard to believe. And when I first read it, I thought, this gets in to high tech of high tech. How many of you have ever heard about all of the scientists that are dying? The scientists that have died. These are scientists that are working on classified stuff like electrical experiments, high-tech electricity, like microbiologists, like these are the men who are working for the government who can support it, or from colleges who have government grants, working in the highest echelons. These scientists, a lot of them are dying for unexplained reasons. They just die. They come up dead. They're working on some highly secret thing, and they come up dead. And you think to yourself, well, what's that got to do with the New World Order? Well, when you find out what they're working on, it's got a lot to do with it. I'm going to take one case this morning. I'm not talking about demons, and I'm not talking about apparitions, and I'm not talking about manifestations. I'm talking about rock hard science, okay? Microbiologists, who are these people? These are the guys who sequence DNA. All right, deoxyribonucleic acid, that DNA, which is the code structure of your body. They sequence it. What are they doing that for? They're trying to find out, and I'm going to read it for you. This is an amazing thing. The headline says this: microbiologist with link to race-based weapon turning up dead. What's that? Let's look closely. Two American scientists worked with were Benito K, 52, Don Wiley, 57. Both microbiologists had been engaged in DNA sequencing that could provide a genetic marker based on genetic profiling. The research could play an important role in developing weaponized pathogens to hit selected groups of humans, identifying them by race. You ever thought of such a thing as that?
Open your mind.
2 years ago, both men were found dead in circumstances never fully explained. You remember how I told you that the elite are racist? You remember what I told you about that? Why would they be, preachers? Root race theory. The seven successive evolutionary progression. The root race theory. Adolf Hitler was one of the most racist men that walked the face of the earth. He made it plain to everybody that blonde-haired, blue-eyed, Nordic-featured, like this killer up here in Norway, that just shot to death all those people, was the Aryan epitome of what a human being should be, and all the rest of the scum underneath aren't even fit to live. Now, I told you that Margaret Sanger, when she started Planned Parenthood, and folks, if you don't believe me, go check it out for yourself, was as racist as she could be to the core. I don't know if you know this or not, but if you go back and if you'll go check, the 50 million kids have been butchered in this country. 50 million. Is that right? Am I correct in that? 50 million abortions. Go find out what percentage of those babies are black. Go find out. Go find out how many Planned Parenthood clinics are located in large cities and out in the urban sprawling areas where there's a concentration of black people, and you'll be amazed at how many of these are black babies. They're controlling the population that way. Now we have microbiologists who can control the population through a pathogen that they can create in a lab that can target a person's race. You say, well, that's insane. Not really. Not really. Nobody knows to this day where AIDS came from. They don't know where AIDS came from. I heard it said 20 years ago it came from the green monkey. I'm sure many of you have heard that too, but nobody ever proved where it came from. There are many people out there who believe AIDS came from a laboratory. They believe that. I can't prove that one way or the other. But I do know that it's created chaos, and I do know that the New World Order will bring order out of chaos. I do know that, and I do know that they have a motive in everything that they do, and that they've already said time and again that the world's population must be reduced.
Open your mind.
They're going to reduce the population, and here's what they plan to have in this new world: the super rich and the herd. No middle class. Middle class will be gone. Last, if you get on Drudge right now, he may still be posted on his main page. Get on Drudge, and you'll see where he says, black middle class eroding quickly. All right? Middle class. The middle class. Europe has the serfdom, and it has the king. All right? That's been the system in Europe. America created a cultural system that's unlike anything else. They had super rich, always have, always will. They had the very poor, but they had the middle class. You see, they had the middle class, the buffer between the super rich who dictated over the very poor. The poor couldn't, they kept them uneducated, they kept them ignorant, they kept them poor, so they could use them and work them. Did you believe that you're doing that today? That's exactly what all these bailouts were about. That's exactly what this New World Order intends to do. It's going to create a super rich class. At one time, Bill Gates was worth $90,000 million.
Open your mind.
That's a pile of money. Right now, he's falling on hard times. He's down about $45 billion, I think, somewhere in there. At one time, that's an unbelievable amount of money. And how did he make that? He didn't make that over generations. When he created Microsoft, and he created Microsoft because he went to work for IBM. IBM wanted somebody to make an operating system for them. IBM was a computer manufacturer, always has been. And you know, way back before them, when you went to a grocery store to buy food, that cash register more than likely was IBM or Royal or something like that. So they wanted an operating system for their computer, their personal computer, so Bill Gates wrote the code for it. He was a computer programmer. That's all he was. And then he created Microsoft. He created Windows. He created an operating system that sat on top of DOS. And now, of course, DOS is gone and it's all Windows. And he monopolized the system. Every PC that came out had Windows on it. And so Bill Gates got a royalty from it. And he monopolized it. You know, they talk about the antitrust laws up there in Washington. They didn't work for him because every PC that was made had Windows on it until Linux came out. And then Mac, of course, has got a different system altogether, but it's a different computer. He became an intensely rich man by doing that. That's what's happening now. You'd believe the rich have lost their money?
Open your mind.
Let me ask you this question. When this deep, deep recession started in 2.5-3 years ago, okay, do you believe any of that money disappeared that was around 3 years ago? Do you believe that money's still around that was around 3 years ago? Okay, it's still around, right? It's just not in your hands. All right? Who did that? Who allowed the housing industry to build? Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, pumping money in, letting people buy houses that didn't even have a job, had no way they could pay a mortgage payment like that, and house after house after house after house after house. They knew that this bubble was building. It was a created prosperity. These houses weren't worth what they were piling all this money into them. The day would come when reality would set in. That's exactly what they wanted. It did. For what? To create a recession like we've been in, they're going to bring something out of that recession. These planners are going to do something with it. What's his face said to Bill Clinton, to Evangelist, wasn't Evangelist Clinton, it was the one that's in there now. Obama, the one who became the mayor of Chicago, he said that you can't let a good crisis go to waste. Rahm Emanuel. All right. I'm talking about the elite. I'm talking about what they're going to use to bring about exactly what they intend to do. And so these scientists come up dead. Here's one at the end. It says, there have been persistent reports. The Institute is also engaged in DNA sequencing research. One former member of the Knesset, Didi Zucker, caused a storm in the Israeli parliament when he claimed that the Institute was trying to create an ethnic-specific weapon in which Arabs could be targeted by Israeli weapons. In World War I, they had biological warfare. You remember that? The gas, all that, the trenches. But now they've got to the point now with technology and with that they've learned enough now to where they apparently can create a weapon that by sequencing DNA. Now it was about 10, 15 years ago, they charted the whole human genome. All right? Something like that. 10 years ago, I forget exactly how long it's been. They charted it. The whole human genome. The genetic structure of the human being. All right, they got all laid out. Okay. This means they have a database built up that they can work from. And they know that if they can get to the point of where they can create a weapon that will wipe out certain races or certain people, then you talk about control over people, they've got control over you, like you wouldn't believe, to force into being what they intend to force into being. Now, when you look around yourself, and what I'm talking about, you know, I've talked about Bird and I've talked about this other stuff. You got to ask yourself the question.
Open your mind.
Well, how long is it going to be then? I mean, they've got all this technology. They've got all this stuff going. How long is it going to be before they bring this together and they do it? They're already doing it. It's already happening. When you look outside, how many of you have noticed these little antennas that have a square box on top of them? That's ELF. That's an ELF antenna. You know what that's for? Ostensibly, it's for this. On the surface of it, that's what it's for. And it may be used, but that's not all it's for. It emits a microwave. Hitler scientists discovered. It's amazing the stuff that's come out of Germany, isn't it? Hitler scientists discovered back in the 30s and the 40s that certain waves could control the behavior of people.
Open your mind.
Control the behavior of people. Now, the radio spectrum is huge, folks. I mean, to give you an idea of what I'm talking about, you tune into a AM station, and you're going from somewhere like 500 to 520 on up to, what, 1600, 1700. Then you tune into an AM station, you get shortwave, you got shortwave radio receivers, you got waves, radio waves that are locked into a certain frequency like aircraft and the military and what have you. There's a huge spectrum of radio waves. They could have chosen out of that huge spectrum of radio waves. They had a huge selection of frequencies to choose for your cell phone. They could, you know, open, it's available. Because that frequency is not practical for a radio receiver like you listen to. So they could choose these frequencies. Guess what frequency they chose? It's a frequency that is right next to what's necessary to control a human being. Isn't that amazing? Now, you've already been warned time and again that these cell phones could cause damage. Overexposure to them, you know. They have, what is that thing where you can look at a body and you can see a hot spot in it? It's some kind of a camera that shows thermal, infrared, something like that. They showed a woman or a man that had been listening on a cell phone, just took the phone away, then they showed a photograph of the same person 10 minutes later, red all over the side there, where this radiation had been emitted from this phones all over the head, and then 10, 15 minutes later, most of it was gone. Okay, now that's a fact. That's rock hard science, okay? It is a fact that radio waves can affect human beings. They're working now. They are investigating. They're doing their work in these laboratories. of just exactly how many of these things they need out there to control mass control of human beings.
Open your mind.
In other words, they can begin to send frequencies into your head, and you wonder, why? Why is it that I'm thirsty? Or why would I like to have an ice cream? Or what? You know, all of a sudden, you know, this desire hits you. It's because they're feeding this stuff into your brain. Now you say, well, that's crazy, preacher.
The only people you don't want to disclose the truth are people with something to hide.
A totalitarian government with a scientific bent might do things that to us would seem horrifying. The Nazis were more scientific than the present rulers of Russia and were more inclined to the atrocities that I have in mind. If they had survived, they would probably have soon taken to scientific breeding. Any nation which adopts this practice will, within a generation, secure great military advantages. The system, one may surmise, will be something like this, except possibly in the governing aristocracy, all but 5% of males and 30% of females will be sterilized.
Open your mind.
The 30% of females will be expected to spend the years from 18 to 40 in reproduction in order to secure adequate cannon fodder. As a rule, artificial insemination will be preferred to the natural method. The unsterilized, if they desire the pleasures of love, will usually have to seek them with sterilized partners.
Open your mind.
The Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter number 2, and verse number 10, that is, with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth. The Lord Jesus Christ is truth personified. He said, I am the way, the truth. Not the truth about the truth. The truth about the truth is fine, but he is the truth. In other words, to receive him is to receive the truth. To reject him is to reject the truth. Because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. Now watch carefully. And this is one of these things in the Bible that just literally you have to kind of look at it and think hard. For this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth but had pleasure in righteousness. All right. So what does that mean? Well, that means that a great deception. The Bible says that in the last days, men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. And the scripture says that they will be deceiving, they will deceive and be deceived. That's what's going on. A deception on a grand scale. I read something last night. As I've been digging, I've been doing a lot of digging. One thing leads to another.
Oppose the secret society, the secret oath, and the secret proceedings. We decided long ago the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment, of pertinent facts, far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it.
Face the facts, join our hands. hands, make a stand. It's time to gather plans, get the shot, take the chance. Till there is no one left, stay correct to the death. They can't ever break a freedom, we will never let it. The corrupt politics is killing the system. Cynicism is it and it's everything that you witness. They tell you what to think, make you believe that they're the realness. They feed us full of lies and yet we always forgive them. Huh? It's all conspiracy. And if you feed an inner witch, you're the puppet. The government's pulling strings from above you. It's time for the introduction to truth and let's start a movement. We've all been brainwashed, they believe that we all are stupid. We believe in what we see and whatever our ears are hearing. But if you look close, listen, gather your own opinion, you'll understand all the lies, lines and what's between them. This world is not your oyster, this world is a fucking prison. Come on! What's happening in our nation? No one will stand up for the fear of assassination. So they strip us of everything. We stand there and just take it. We're scared to make a stand, a false flag operation. Research Illuminati, find out by 9/11. You see they line their pockets, don't believe the lies they tell it. Find and seek the truth, realize we need to do whatever it is we can to protect our livelihood. It's time for us to prove whether conspiracy or not. They owe some explanations to the questions that we got. What are the skull and bones? What is lying beneath? All these secretive meats got you lying between your teeth. What's with the Bilderberg? I'm burning your effigies. I'm praying a Lucifer. How Satanist can you be? While all of the time praying you believing in the beast just to keep up appearances within Christianity. Come on. Try to shut us down or turn around, let us storm them. We got the warnings, let us march from the morning through the night. We gon' fight and close the eye and hope.